Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Zena Outreach Foundation Talk. Today's talk is about de-addiction. We have wonderful personality, Mr. Luther, Rahul Luther, who's going to talk about de-addiction on this wonderful Sunday evening, which is a widespread evening right now. And me, Kapil Dev, your host for the evening. And we'll take you to the next 2 hours with this wonderful, wonderful topic about de-addiction, how we have to how Mr. Luther has gone to this addiction and how he has overcome the addiction and how his trust helps the people to de-addict with all kind of alcohol, be it smoke, or be it any addictions that he runs his wonderful trust here in Hyderabad. Without wasting much of a time, we have this event. Purpose of the event is primarily to make people understand what addiction is and why it is such a blatant word and why we all have to be serious about it. It's rapidly happening. It could be addiction for mobile, it could be addiction for technology, it could be addiction for substances. But addiction is a term that we need to address to and address to the and particularly during this time of pandemic, it's a proven word. It also results to psychological illnesses in many ways. I'm no expert on that, but the expert today, Mr. Luther, will guide us through. Before he gets on to talk about it, we have this brief introduction about the vision of Zena Worlds and Outreach Foundation, which is pioneered by Mr. Rajiv, a wonderful person, Rajiva Anand, wonderful person from the wonderful city in Bihar, to help us through with this, and his person who's got actually joined us all together. So before we get to start this event, I would like to hear a round of noise from you guys, or hula hoos, or claps from all of you people. That's getting the spirit going. That's getting the spirit going. So I have this small trick, if you all can try on the clap before we all go it, is join your hands together, all of you, and take your one finger and clap. And two fingers, three fingers, and four fingers, and five fingers. So, welcome all. I'm overhearing some noise. If people you could correct it, please, somebody. Some technical difficulty. I would now request Nandita, who could do us the honors of playing the vision video of Zena World to the audience, please.
Can I be made the host?
Yes, Mr. Rajiva, if you could just have the technical thing running through.
Just a second.
Nandita, by the way, is also a techie, and she does this wonderful job on behind the screens and in front of the screen. She's also a wonderful orator herself, a wonderful human being.
Thank you. More than anything, I'm a Hyderabadi.
अरे अरे हम भी हैदराबादी है भाई.
Just a second, I am playing
सुबह
back.
उठ के चाय पीते और कुछ नहीं करते.
मस्का बन नहीं खाते.
मस्का बन भी खा लेते. यस
Just let me know if you are able to see my screen.
वी
You
आर
are? Okay.
जस्ट एनलार्जन इट
I
एंड
will, I will, I will.
So the Zena vision video, all the way coming to you, all the audience, please
World
take it
Vision.
away.
We are a family, bringing joy, happiness, prosperity in our lives and around by nurturing, encouraging, catalyzing, enabling 360-degree well-being in physical, intellectual, emotional, social, and economic dimensions. Our vision, abundance of joy, happiness, care, and prosperity for all. Our Our mission, we strive for alleviating pain, suffering and poverty, encouraging unshackled-free thoughts, enabling dignified jobs and livelihood, nurturing close family bonding, seeking joy and happiness in the impact cost. Our values, passion, work with passion and from heart. Our values, humility, learning attitude, mutual respect, and open to listening to others. Our values, integrity, sincere, honest, and ethical principles. Our values, empathy, understand and feel others as your own. Our values, humanity, have compassion, brotherhood, fellow feeling, and kindness. Our values, joy, work that brings joy and value, diversity and inclusion. Our character, trust, belief, faith and confidence in self and in others, from where love and compassion emanate. Our character, virtue, high moral values, patience, consideration, trustworthiness and forgiveness. Our character, transparency, honesty, openness and not guarded. Thank you.
Wow, 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 wow. So wasn't that some information, everybody? And well, I got into a sleep for some time because of the kind of music that was running through. And
Sorry.
Keep going. Keep going. That's lighting up the mood, Nandita.
And that was also from Zena family only, sung yes, by Colonel Nishan Singh. So it went to the next YouTube video, which was Nishan.
Yeah, that's all right. See, we all have to be excused right now because of the virtual world and that becoming the real world. Even I'm not a techie. I'm trying to learn things from my nephew right now to use all of these gadgets. And it is so complex that I have this gadget with me. I have a tablet. I have my laptop. I also have a computer. So there are a lot of gadgets around and we can all take an excuse for that, don't we, all of us? So we have a keynote address by a wonderful gentleman who's going to talk about today's event. He's going to give the address to all of us and addressing and also introducing this wonderful gentleman. Enough. He is Mr. Neeraj, a chemical engineer from IIT Bombay, and I am Ahmedabad. Sir, itna padh liya to main ye kaam nahi kar pata tha. All jobless people do hosting, like me. Koi kuch nahi aata to mic pakad ke baat karo neta ki tarah. So he has a short stint in corporate, and with his love for his land, which is a birthplace of Sardar Patel, Nadiad, he's back there. He hails from a wonderful family, lives in his ancestral home, which is 250 years, that was told to us. We all are willing to and wanting to see this this place for sure, once the pandemic is over, at least experience Gujarat through his eyes. So he has a passion for teaching and academics, and his interest in education and heritage preservation that is doing that. Let us all welcome Neeraj ji, who is going to give us the welcome note address for the audience today. Neeraj ji, take it away.
Good
Neeraj ji. Looking forward to hear from you, Neeraj ji. Can I make a request to everybody? Could you just can mute your mics apart from Mr. Neeraj? I would appreciate everybody if you can mute your mics. And we just want to hear to Mr. Neeraj ji. Neeraj, Yajnik ji, can you take it away, giving the welcome note address, please?
No, I'm extremely sorry. I have been so badly called away for 2 minutes. Can you please do something about that? I'll be joining back in 2 minutes.
Oh, you want to join back?
I'm extremely sorry for that.
All right. So in the meanwhile, that's fine. I would just want some of the audience to share their experience with the Zena World. Anyone who can talk about their experience with Zena World before the welcome address begins. Nandita, can you just talk your experience about Zena World?
Sure. You know, since we all got very active into Zena, let's say a year back or so, most of us have been meeting such lovely people coming from such wonderful backgrounds, highly educated, highly creative. And I'm so happy meeting people who are great painters, singers. Sometimes, you know, when I see all of them, I feel really, oh my God, there's so much more to life than just work. And that has been a real eye-opener for me that, you know, we put in so many hours into our daily mundane work and we forget right. that there's so much more to life. And Zena has brought that back to me that there is so much more to life rather than just work. Almost every member here is so special. They have something, you know, so creative about them. And they're all very doing some great work in their daily professions, but still they have so much time for doing what they're passionate about. And that's a great balance, which I take out from Zena, that you can really do your work and you can really have a lot of interests and passions, which, people in Zena are very, very successful in doing. So I'm happy meeting a lot of painters these days in Zena, a lot of great singers, and there are people who are chefs who are doing great cooking. And I think that's what Rajivji brings to the table. He's brought in people with such diverse backgrounds, and yet everyone has that commonality of having interest in, you know, all the things that these people are doing. I think that's what Zena brings to the table for me.
I think he's also brought us Hyderabadis together also.
Absolutely.
No, Kapil and Nandita, you both, I'm just taking for granted because I thought I have already cornered. Luther Bhaiya has already joined Zena family, by the way.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful to know.
He does not have any scope of running away, because when you requested somebody to share their views about Zena family, a phenomenal guy in Mr. Luther, his very close friend, Atul Bhaiya, reached right. out to him, invited him over, and he is present today only because he wants to see his friend do those magical tricks. So Atul Bhaiya, two words from you.
Arey, hum Hyderabadi bahut dil ke acche rehte hain, bindaas rehte hain.
Atul Bhaiya, do shabd.
I don't want to take any glory away from my good friend Rahul Luther. Rahul and I were.
Atul was a very bad guy, but he spent few years in Hyderabad, so we turned him into a good guy now.
So when we were in college, in Sri Ram College in Delhi, okay. I went on to graduate from the college while Rahul slid down the slope of his addiction.
Okay.
And, his distraught father, like, pulled him by the scruff of his neck and put him in some college in Hyderabad. Nizam College, if I'm not mistaken.
Nizam College, yeah.
From where he graduated. But anyway, you know, it's really, life is about how you finally land up. And I'm, as his friend, I'm very happy that he's landed up very firmly on the ground and he's doing great service.
Resolute and great service.
All the bad things he has put to good use now.
I think we have the keynote address ready. Can we have Mr. Neeraj talking?
Yes, thank you.
Yes,
Kapil ji.
Yes.
I'm back. I'm sorry I was called away for that and sorry for disrupting. It is a very, very tough task to say something about somebody who has, well, only from the profiles we knew that Mr. Luther has been he spent a long time in this work, in this field that he has chosen for himself. And only now I learned how deep the passion goes. So it is a very, very challenging task that I am having. It's, in a sense, it is good. And I would say that, well, I will not go into the addiction side of it because I'm not qualified enough for that. And Mr. Luther definitely is. But a couple of things only I wanted to say were that things which have not always taken up our attention for addiction is they are now coming up. One of the things we have seen is the addiction to mobile, or previously it was the internet addiction. Now it has become worse because now it is the mobile addiction. Well, again, I'm not qualified to talk about it, but it is going from alcohol to drugs. It knocks you out totally, makes you totally addicted. And one which is coming up even worse than this, because of the influence of the mobile on the politics and on the ideas, is our addiction to our ideas and our biases. Yes. I think that is taking up the level of addiction now, rather than merely idea fixation or bias. Obviously, again, I'm not qualified, but I find in my friend group also, I find it very difficult sometimes to let go of my own ideas. And definitely it is very, very difficult to let go of the mobile addiction. And I'm sure that at some time in his talk, Mr. Luther would definitely give us some hints about how to go about this and kill our own mobile addiction, which I would definitely say I'm a junkie. Without doubt. But what I see in my students is it even worse. Like you can say that, well, I've had a full life in a sense. At the age I am at, a generation back, many people would be dead or on the way out, they would say. That today we say that, no, we are not dead at 65. We are not dead at 75. Today some people are saying that 80 is the new 40. Now, whatever it is. But what I see in the generation next is that is in my students, because I've been teaching for the last few years. What I see is horrifying. These people, they know nothing beyond the mobile. So whether they should be weaned away or what do you do? How do you manage the addiction? Because that's not unlikely to go away at all. So I am sure Mr. Luther would talk about it. Since we live in India, I would just end my sort of keynote by saying that just as there will be future newer types of addictions, there were some older types of addictions also earlier. And having lived in a country with, say, maybe 5,000 years of civilization, we might pay a little thought to the kind of addictions that used to be there earlier. There is an interesting Sanskrit Subhashit. I will not go into the Subhashit itself, but the meaning is that there are many types of addictions, but only two good addictions are that. One addiction is the addiction to studies and learning. And the other addiction is the addiction of taking the name of God. Vidya Vyasanam Vyasanam Athava Harinama Sevanam Vyasanam. Wow. I will leave it at this, because these are the only two addictions from which perhaps one should not wean a person away. All the other addictions, including the one I mentioned about my own addiction, I'm sure Mr. Luther would be there to guide us away from this. I think I will let it like this.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the wonderful address today and wonderful person that you are. We still look forward to come to Nadiad as soon as possible once the entire pandemic is done.
Because if nothing else, I will make. If you don't come, I'll make a video and send you. Also, better you.
Yeah, maybe we'll do a detour there. A vlog with this waiting. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. Without much of waiting, let me introduce our speaker for today. Speaker for today is Mr. Luther. Hails from the legendary family. His father is a legendary person from the city of Hyderabad. Mr. Luther has passed out from this wonderful elite school called Hyderabad Public School, Begumpet, from 73. Also happens to be my super duper senior from the same fraternity, the same alumnus, proud alumnus of the HPS. He has had this his time addicted to substances, and that is going to share through with this today's topic. And he founded this wonderful organization called Hope Trust, and who's a graduate from English Literature and Philosophy and Psychology. He worked for 25 years in the corporate sector before joining the social service sector. He has over 20 years of experience in addiction treatment, established the first care and support facility for people affected by HIV/AIDS in Andhra Pradesh, as well as first rehabilitation center for addiction in the state. He has assisted several private and government agencies in setting up addiction-related policies and facilities in India and abroad, including Sultanate of Oman, United Kingdom, and Bangladesh. He publishes articles in leading national publications, speaks on national, international radio and TV well, and lectures extensively on subjects of addictions all over the world. That's quite an achievement, considering the fact of his past. He's a former addict, and personal experiences adds authenticity to his authority on the subject. About this trust, established in 2002, has earned an international reputation for ethical and effective treatment for addictions and mental health issues. It also offers residential and outpatient and online therapy. Hope Trust has also international affiliation with Canadian and UK-based treatment organization. He speaks about causes, effects, and recovery. Also an awardee from Rotary International. I have been a fellow Rotarian myself, served with the organization 5 years. We so look forward to see hear from you, Mr. Luther. Please take it away.
Yeah, thank you. But somebody will have to make me the co-host.
Yeah, you are already.
I see.
Okay. Well, you want a co-host. Rajivaji, you should probably have Mr. Luther made as the co-host.
Yeah, because it's disabled.
Yes. Give us a second. Just talk us through once the update is done. Mr. Luther has requested to be made the co-host. Rajivaji, if you could do the honors.
Yeah, I think it's done.
Yes. Yes, sir. Very good evening. Hope you're doing fine.
Yeah, thank you for introducing me. And it's a pleasure to be on this forum.
All right.
Of such enthusiastic people. I saw in one of the goals of our mission is to be open-minded, to be transparent, to be unguarded, something like that. So that's what I really appreciate. 1 minute. I also have to. Okay. Can you see the PowerPoint?
Not yet.
I see.
Have you shared it?
Okay, maybe something is... I'm also not as technologically savvy as my wife is.
Rahulji, just open it on your laptop first and then share it.
First, I have to click on share screen.
No, no. Open the presentation on your laptop first, and then come back to Zoom and share it from there.
Okay, done.
Okay.
Now come back to Zoom. Okay.
And now share it. When you share it, you'll see the window and share that window.
Yes. I've done it so many times, but every time I have to relearn.
Learning, unlearning, and relearning, a method of thing.
Just make it into into a slideshow.
Yeah.
Nandita, maybe you need to teach us all the technology that you learn. The expert that you are.
It's become a necessity nowadays. No, you can't do without it.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's addictively unaddicted.
So no. At the bottom, there is this slideshow kind of thing. No, you can press that one.
F5.
FI or this, yeah. At the bottom of your presentation, the third icon. That is also okay.
Yeah, the presentation by Mr. Rahul Luter on de-addiction is right at your screens. Audience, please enjoy this presentation from Mr. Rahul Luter. Take it away, sir.
Yeah, so we are going to talk about addictions, both to substances and behavior addictions. Behavior addictions could mean, as was mentioned, about mobile addiction, and there are other behavior addictions. But to understand the treatment or recovery from addiction, we need to understand what is addiction, what is the current scientific understanding of addiction, what may be the causes, what are the effects, and subsequently, what are the treatment methodologies. Now, addiction has always been looked at as a stigma, because you may, when I first mentioned, that I myself am an addict, some of you I could make out are pretty shocked that, when they said, what is your interest and passion? So I first mentioned that I'm an addict and alcoholic, because that's the first thing we need to learn in recovery, is to be honest, is to be open-minded and declare that, this is a problem I have, because I now understand that addiction is a disease. It's not that I'm a bad person. It's not that I'm a mad person, but I'm a sick person, because leading medical authorities now recognize addiction as a disease, just like any other disease, like diabetes or heart disease or something else. So when you have any other disease, you don't have to hide it. So that is why we need to educate ourselves about what is addiction, that it's a disease, and it's not that the person is bad or mad, though he may appear bad in the sense that he may indulge in, excuse me. He may indulge in certain, he or she may indulge in some so-called bad activities like hiding, lying, cheating, manipulating, or he may appear crazy or mad that he is going on repeating a behavior which is actually harming him. The first time it was called a disease was in 1935, even in USA. Before 1935, it was widely recognized as a moral shortcoming or a lack of upbringing, or that he was, as even now, when families come to me and the mothers say, my son is a good guy, but he fell into the wrong company, as if some gang of wrong company is roaming around looking for their son and catching them and making them into addicts. It's the son himself who's seeking like-minded people. So Alcoholics Anonymous, how many of you have heard of Alcoholics Anonymous?
Heard of it, sir. Heard of
it. Yeah. So Alcoholics Anonymous is a worldwide fellowship for recovery from alcohol. And from their principles of 12 steps, so many other 12-step groups have come up, like Overeaters Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, Sex Anonymous, etc., etc. There are more than 25 groups like that, founded by the co-founders Bill W. and Dr. Bob. Bill W. or Bill Wilson was a stockbroker, and Dr. Bob was a physician. And AA defines addiction as a twofold disease, an allergy of the body coupled with an obsession of the mind. Now, that means it has two aspects, a physical aspect and a mental aspect. So what do we mean by allergy of the body? Allergy of the body means if we are allergic to any substance, for example, if I am allergic to fish, then if I eat fish, then there will be an abnormal reaction. Maybe my body will break out in rashes. But if another person who is not allergic to fish can eat fish and nothing is going to happen to him or her. Similarly, since I am allergic to alcohol, if I drink alcohol, there is an abnormal reaction. What happens is when I take a drink, a craving is triggered and I've got to have a second and third and fourth till I fall flat on my face. And the more I'm going out of control, the more my mind tells me that I'm in control. While a person who is not allergic to alcohol can have a peg, maybe two, and then he will, you know, say, okay, and then he will have dinner with the family, he will watch TV, and he will go to sleep. So he's not allergic to alcohol. And an obsession of the mind. Obsession of the mind is you're all the time thinking about your alcohol or drugs or even your mobile phone or whatever it may be. So it takes precedence over everything else, you know, how to hide it, how to control it, how to acquire it, where to drink. So also there are many definitions in this book of Alcoholics Anonymous, which is called the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. And one of the definitions I like personally is that it's a soul sickness. You know, it's so deep. Sickness is so deep that it is a soul sickness. Subsequently, in 1956, the American Medical Association also officially classified it as a disease. Again, they called it an illness. Preoccupation means, again, the mental obsession. Loss of control means that you can not have just one or two drinks. You've got to keep drinking. Progression means that as time goes by, your body develops tolerance. You need more and more of that substance to get high. And you tend to relapse. That means if you may stop, you may stop for a day, a week, a month, but you are likely to go back. And then it causes emotional and occupational and social problems. And it is a type of a drug dependence. Now, one thing is that many people think differentiate alcohol and drugs, especially when you have an alcoholic who comes, whose choice of drug is alcohol, and they come for treatment, they consider themselves superior to drug addicts. They say, oh, I don't touch drugs, you know, I only drink alcohol. But alcohol is a drug. It has a chemical formula, CH2O4. It is ethanol. Only thing is because it is legally available, socially acceptable, and very nicely advertised, you know, 100 Pipers, Black Dog, Johnny Walker. So we view it as different. But it's a drug which causes more deaths, more divorces, more road accidents, more hospital admissions than any other drug. It's the oldest drug known to mankind. The now, so addiction is defined as a chronic. Chronic means incurable. We'll come to all this later. Relapse prone, compulsion, and drinking or using or indulging in the addictive behavior despite having harmful consequences and causing brain damage. So now there is the DSM-5, you know, which is the medical criteria for diagnosis for mental disorders, and they will not go into too much all this because you know, they tend to say that there is a mild, then there is a moderate, and there is a severe form. So basically, we'll go through these points. The substance, that is the alcohol or the drugs or the behavior, addictive behavior, is often taken in larger amounts or over a longer period than was intended. There is a persistent desire or unsuccessful effort, that means to cut down or to control the use of the substance. That means the person attempts to stop, tries to stop, but is unable to stop. He or she spends a lot of time in trying to get the substance, in using the substance. Maybe, you know, you have to slip into bathrooms, you have to hide somewhere, and then to get over the hangover. There is a craving, that means there is a strong desire to again and again use the substance. And then there is a failure to fulfill, you know, the social or career-oriented obligations. This is a very important one, that you continue to use the substance despite having problems in all areas of your life, whether it's health-related, whether it's money, whether it is career, whether it is at school, whether it's in family relationships, you still keep on using it. And all the other social and your career oriented obligations are either you give them up or your using takes precedence over them. You use them in a very sometimes in an unsafe way, like for example, drinking and driving is a typical example. You have the knowledge, you may be educated, you know it is harmful, but you still continue to use, and you develop tolerance. Tolerance means that you need more and more of that substance to get the same high. Then when you stop, you experience withdrawal. It can be physical, it can be psychological, or it can be both. Different substances have different withdrawals. In fact, in our experience, the withdrawal from drugs is not as dangerous as withdrawal from alcohol. Alcohol withdrawal can be fatal. You know, you can have delirium tremens and other brain-related regression, which can cause death. So, and then to relieve that withdrawal, you've got to have that substance or some other substitute substance. So this is the technical part. Some of the common drugs are alcohol, cannabis, ganja, hashish, charas, very, very traditional in India. And now, of course, worldwide, you also have hafeem in India, nicotine. Then you have tranquilizers or sleeping pills or anti-anxiety drugs. You have, you know, amphetamines and cocaine and methamphetamine now. You have hallucinogens like mushrooms or LSD. And lesser cost, you get cough syrup, painkillers. Now there are behavioral addictions, which may include eating. You have a disease called bulimia, which Princess Diana suffered from it famously. That means you go on obsessively eating and then you need to puke. Then there's gambling. People have lost all their money and everything, family, because of gambling. There is internet or video gaming. Some people are addicted to love. Some people are addicted to sex. Some people go to the gym obsessively. Some people are addicted to work. And some people are addicted to shopping, which I do now tremendously on Amazon. So each of the person tries to hide, justify, or rationalize that, you know, a person who's, for example, addicted to work will not have a balance in their life. You know, they will be all the time working and their family will be neglected. They will not spend quality time with family. But they will justify it by saying, you know, that I'm earning money, I'm learning, I'm whatever, you know. So now addiction is very widespread. WHO estimates that 10% of the world population, that means 10 people out of 100 people, is addicted to alcohol or drugs. That means if you have a company of 100 people working, 10 people are likely to have an addiction. Or if you have a family of 10, extended family of 10 members, one person is likely to be addicted. And you know, strangely, in our class in Hyderabad Public School, we had 30 students. And then later on I discovered that there were three of us who turned out to be alcoholics and addicts. One died, one is in recovery in Canada, and I'm one here. The rest of them are all normal, you know, kind of people. And it's not that every drinker becomes an alcoholic or that we are against alcohol. 2 out of 10 drinkers will have a tendency to develop an addiction, and the other 8 can drink normally. There's no problem. Now, if we are calling it a disease, then it will have definite characteristics. Every disease has some characteristics. So these are the characteristics: primary, progressive, characterized by denial. It's called a family disease. It is incurable. It is relapse prone. It is treatable and it is fatal. So we'll just quickly go through all this. Primary. Primary means that addiction, genetic factor means that addiction tends to run in families, just like diabetes, heart disease, or mental problems. So if you're, it's not necessary that your father is an alcoholic or addict. It could be your great grandfather, it could be some uncle or whatever. So basically, in your extended family, if you have a tendency, if you have some alcoholics and addicts, there will be a predisposition for you to develop addiction. Now, most of the people say, no, my grandfather used to be quietly sitting in a rocking chair, reading the Hindu and all that, and sipping tea the whole day. How do you know what was in that glass? Maybe it was Afim. You know, as BS kids don't know what our grandfather was up to. So the second is a biochemical factor. You know, in our brain, we have chemicals that are responsible for our thinking and our feeling, such as serotonin, endorphins, and the most famous of them and directly linked with addiction is called dopamine. It is also called the feel-good chemical. Now, it's been proven that alcoholics and addicts are born with an insufficient or imbalance in their dopamine levels. And I'm not going into the long story of how it leads to that, but when they drink or when they indulge in, like all of us, you know, if we are fond of ice cream or chocolate or like people who are addicted to horse racing when they attend a race or watch cricket, there is a boost of dopamine level. So when there is a boost of dopamine level, you feel good and you want to repeat that good experience. So and since the substance that you are taking may have a tendency to maybe addictive, so your body starts developing an addiction, and you keep on repeating that, and you know that leads to. This is a long story, but in short, this is how it is. So in primary also basically means that the problem is inside of you and not outside of you. You are not drinking because of some outside factor. Yes, environment does play a major role, but mostly environment plays the role of the choice of drug. For example, if you are born a Christian and you live in a Christian community, then it's quite likely that you would maybe developing alcoholism than drug addiction, because in Christian communities, alcohol is a part of their lifestyle. If you are in a Muslim community, maybe in Oman, like we have a lot of contact there, alcohol is very difficult to get for the locals. For foreigners, there's no problem. You know, they don't want to smell, they don't want to indulge in black market. So, and Iran supplies them heroin from across the sea, which is very close by. So there are a lot of drug addicts. So it's also the accessibility, the availability, what is the environmental availability of which drug is in good supply. Progressive means that with time, the quantity and frequency will keep on increasing, because basically the body develops tolerance. Not only the quantity and frequency, but the damages caused in all areas, health, financial, relationships, reputation, everything goes on increasing. Now, Alcoholics Anonymous also defines it as a cunning, baffling, and powerful disease. That is because it is characterized by denial. That means the person having the problem doesn't believe or cannot see that they have a problem. It's like, you know, in the olden days, if you saw a movie, maybe Rajendra Kumar or Amitabh Bachchan, you know, suppose there is a scene in which his mother dies and the villagers bring the dead body to the hut, and he comes out and he sees the mother's dead body. So what will he say? Can anyone tell me what's the first reaction of that kind of a situation? Yeah? All of you on mute?
Yes, sir.
So what kind of reaction will Amitabh Bachchan have when he sees his mother's dead body? You know, in Hindi movies,
he says, "This cannot happen. This cannot
happen." Exactly. How can it not happen? The mother's dead body is in front of us. And how can it not happen? Everyone is going to die. So that is the same thing, you know, because of the stigma attached. Because you can't say I'm an alcoholic. You know, that means you're a bevda. There are all kinds of, you know, in Telugu, there's another very ugly sounding word. or you can't say I'm a drug addict, you know. So you have to hide the fact. And if you start admitting that you have a problem, then you have to take the solution. Now, solution may be very difficult to take. You may have to go and spend months in a rehab. You have to start getting honest, which we are not used to being, you know. You have to start getting humble, which you have never been. You have been very arrogant. You have to take leave. And so there are a lot of, getting into recovery is very difficult. Getting honest is very difficult. It's very easy to be in denial and say, I don't have a problem. You have a problem. You know? I'm sure many of you know addicts and alcoholics in your life, whether it's family members or friends or colleagues, and you see how difficult it is to convince them that they have a problem. So if a person doesn't believe they have a problem, they're not going to take a solution. So the first step in therapy is to break this denial. You know, it can't be fully broken, but at least some dent can be made. And only then the person agrees to take a treatment. In my case, for example, for nearly 10, 12 years, I never thought I had a problem. And when my parents kicked me out of the house, and my wife and my daughter were staying with them, and then my wife took divorce, my parents kept her, and then they threw me out of the house. I thought she had done some black magic on them, you know. Okay, how can parents throw a son out and keep the daughter-in-law at home and that kind of thing? Now looking back, you know, it was actually, I used to believe that, you know. Now, these are some of the common forms of denial. One is minimizing. Yes, I peeta hoon, I drink. But it's not so bad. I don't drink as much as Mr. Subramaniam next door. You see, he beats his wife, he falls down. I don't beat my wife. Or blaming and projecting. I drink because my wife doesn't understand me, or my boss doesn't understand me. Or rationalizing, you know, especially these marketing kind of people, that my job is full of stress. Evening, I need to come and relax. Now, the thing is, when you drink, you don't get actually relaxed. Your wife gets stressed out. Morning, you get a hangover. So to relax, there are so many other ways. There's yoga, there's meditation, there's music, there's reading. There's so many ways. Drinking is not the way to relax. Then intellectualizing. You know, those who are lawyers or doctors, or those who are highly educated, they argue a lot, you know, they talk a lot. The doctor says, you know, I know what is an alcoholic. You don't tell me. I know what impact it has on the liver. Then diverting. When a friend brings up the topic of drinking, the alcoholic's response is immediately he'll change, you know, something like, oh, what is, I believe your company is going in for diversification, or you're planning to go to Delhi. And you're not able to get a ticket. I know some travel agent who can get you a ticket. Whatever, he'll change the topic immediately. I'm using the word alcohol as a convenience in this presentation. It could mean any other substance, or it could mean any other behavioral addiction also. Then hostility. Whenever the topic of addiction is brought up, the person gets very angry. And then the person who's trying to be helpful withdraws, or silence. You go on talking, you go on lecturing, you go on threatening. So the person keeps on listening, doesn't react. And then after you leave, the person will continue with what he or she wants to do. In short, the alcoholic uses alibis, blames, threatens, charms, boasts, and avoids to silence the well-wishers. Now, this denial is actually reinforced or made stronger by the family members, what is called enabling behavior, by they go on protecting, rescuing, and tolerating the alcoholic so that he doesn't face the consequences of his behavior. They cover up for him. If he's not able to go to office, the wife may ring up the boss and say, you know, he poor guy, I mean, he's got a dentist appointment. They will not share the truth with other family members. They're not able to attend a family function. So they will give some other excuse. So when the alcoholic or addict doesn't face the consequences of his behavior, he doesn't feel the need to change, because he's rescued every time. And he believes he doesn't have a major problem because all the problems are being solved by the family. So the family is actually enabling him to continue his addiction. You get me?
Yes.
It is called a family disease because the entire family undergoes a lot of stress. The alcoholics and addicts are technically called dependents. They are dependent on a substance for their well-being, and the families are called codependents. So just like there is Alcoholics Anonymous for the alcoholics, there is Narcotics Anonymous for the drug addicts, and other 12-step meetings are there for other addictions. So there is Al-Anon family group for the family members, especially of wives and parents of alcoholics. And there is Alateen for younger children of alcoholics, because the children of alcoholics are the greatest sufferers. So even in Hyderabad, there is a huge Al-Anon fellowship. Hyderabad has lots of AA meetings. India has lots of AA meetings. Almost every town, city, everywhere it is available. So this is just to show how the alcoholics and addicts' feelings are almost the same. For example, you take the second one, fear. An alcoholic's life is full of fear. You know, unknown fears, fear of the future, fear of getting caught in small lies, like when he comes back and somebody asks, what did you have? Wife asks, what did you drink? So they may say, you know, I just had a glass of beer, but actually a fear of getting caught with the bottle, which is hidden. Fear of whether he'll be able to get his booze tomorrow, whether it is a dry day tomorrow. Fear of people finding out what his real self is. So he's ruled by fear. So when a person is angry, they will be aggressive. And when the alcoholic is continually aggressive with the family starts getting scared. Today, what is he going to say? So they will pussyfoot around him. They will, you know, make sure that they don't make him angry. Then the last one, you can see low self-worth, you know. An alcoholic or addict goes through a lot of losses. They lose jobs, they lose money, they lose health, they lose friends, they lose reputation, they lose opportunities, they lose time. So when they lose so many things, they feel very small. They have low self-esteem. And a person with low self-esteem, how does he express himself? He compensates with grandiosity. You know, they make big plans. They talk big. I'm going to set up this project. I know YSR. I know this, that, you know, whatever, big talk. And they also become very critical. They become critical of their CEO. They become critical of the chief minister. They become critical of the prime minister. Anybody become critical of their wives. So they want to bring down everybody to their level so that they feel good. So when they're continually being critical with the family starts feeling low self-worth, you know, because they keep on criticizing them. But somewhere down the line, they start believing maybe we are wrong somewhere. They cannot understand what's going on, and they're trying to find a cause, a reason, or a solution to the whole very perplexing situation. So you can see the alcoholic's feelings is and the family's feelings are almost the same. Now, it is incurable, just like diabetes, heart disease. There's so many incurable diseases, because an alcoholic will remain an alcoholic, but he can be sober, he can be clean. There are millions of examples. There are over 7 million members of AA today in the world who are sober. They're very famous personalities. For example, President Bush of USA we call ourselves recovering alcoholic. We don't say recovered because we never recover. It's like if you have diabetes, you still have diabetes, you know. You can't be cured of diabetes. So you have to change your lifestyle or maybe take medication or maybe have some sort of a maintenance program to remain healthy and sober. Buzz Aldrin, for example, of second man on the moon, you know, after Neil Armstrong, he was an alcoholic. When he came back, he went through a very long treatment program, first medical, this, that, and then finally he went to AA, and then his ego was so big that he had to be, his book is very beautiful to read about that. So it is treatable, but it is incurable. It's highly relapse prone. If you do not maintain your sobriety by rigorous maintenance, then you're likely to relapse. So the statistics say that about 33% of people who get into treatment, they are successful the first time, they have long-term sobriety. The other 33.5% of people may relapse once or twice, and then they are successful and are able to stay sober. And the last 33 1/3 of the people keep on relapsing and die. So that is why it is fatal. You can have an early death because of an overdose, a road accident, or like Elvis Presley, slip in the bathroom, you know, fall down the steps. So many ways. Then there are so many diseases which are directly linked with addiction, pancreatitis, cirrhosis, etc. Then there are needles, of course, they cause other hepatitis B and HIV and etc. Now, addiction affects all areas of the addict's life. The physical, that means obviously when you take a substance either through your stomach or through your lungs, or even when you indulge in, say, internet behavior or whatever, so you lose sleep. So all this affects your body. Then there is a psychological impact. Alcoholics and addicts indulge in addictive behavior because that substance goes into their body, then travels to their brain and creates a short circuit. Different chemicals cause different types of short circuits. For example, ganja or marijuana or weed expands the brain cells and deposits in between the brain cells. Or alcohol kills brain cells. So repeatedly, if you do indulge in any substance use, then you obviously your brain is going to get damaged. Then you're going to have some consequence like maybe slower thinking, maybe memory problem, focusing, attention span, etc. Then emotional impact. The emotional response of an addict to a situation is not proportionate to the situation. Small incident, big reaction. Big incident, no reaction. Then the spiritual part, as in the mission statement, it said, you know, what is spiritual part? You know, being good, being caring, compassionate, loving, open-minded, honest, your ethical system, your value system, that gets eroded. You lie, cheat, con, steal, manipulate, hide. Basically, you are dishonest. And your relationships get impacted, relationships with your family, your colleagues, your seniors, even relationships with institutions, whether it's your college, whether it's your office, whether it's the municipal corporation, whether it's the police department, and your relationship with the higher power or God, you know, that all gets impacted. So, therefore, any recovery has to be holistic. It's a bio, that means body, psycho, that means psychological, socio means relationship, and spiritual means the ethical value system. So all these areas get affected. So any treatment has to be holistic. When all these areas are affected, it means basically your personality gets impacted. So AA says that you need a profound personality change. That's what recovery is all about. Now, holistic treatment is nowadays the best is to have an integrated treatment. You have the 12 steps, that means AA or NA. Then you have psychotherapy, like which what psychologists do, like cognitive behavior therapy. You have group therapy. Every person also needs to be evaluated whether they have a psychiatric problem or not. Usually in a country like India, what the family members do is they refer the person to a psychiatrist first. Now, the psychiatrist being a doctor, he's going to ask a question like, why do you drink so much? So the alcoholic, you know, they're very clever. So they will say, sir, I'm drinking because, you know, because of this problem and that problem and that problem. Actually, those problems have come because he's drinking. So he says, you know, I'm very sad. So the moment the psychiatrist hears the word sad, he's going to prescribe him some antidepressant. Then he will say, sir, without drinking, I cannot sleep. So he will give him some sleeping tablet. Now the alcoholic has access or the addict has access to both his choice of substance, antidepressants, and sleeping tablets. So he's going to mix and match and he'll make a nice cocktail. So you have to assess whether the person actually has a psychiatric problem. Sometimes the psychiatric problem is pre-existing and the person is later on developed an addiction. Or because of long-term addiction, he may have developed a psychiatric problem. So it's not important and it's not easy, not possible to determine what came first. It's like the chicken came first or the egg came first. But if they have two problems, then you call it a dual diagnosis. Then both the things have to be treated, because if you don't treat the psychiatric problem, then that will cause a relapse. Or if you don't treat the addiction, then the addiction will compound the psychiatric problem. And if there is a psychiatric problem, then an intervention, that means maybe medication may be required. Then traditional therapies such as yoga, art therapy, meditation also are good to be combined. And each treatment person has to be individualized, because each family dynamics are separate, are different, where they're coming from. No, there will be cultural differences.
Sir, can you just cut short? I'm overhearing some voices. Please mute your mics, please, everybody. Wonderful, interesting. Kindly, everybody, mute your mics except for Mr. Luther.
I can also mute mine then.
I said except for Mr. Luther. Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So, for example, we used to get a lot of clients from Oman. And it was very interesting to see that their cultural dynamics are very similar to ours. You know, the mother is very important in the family. They have a lot of respect for elders. And those guys are, the addicts from Oman used to be very, very honest. You know, then we also used to get clients from UK or America. And they used to have other issues, you know, the cultural shock issues. Their parents are from, you know, maybe Hyderabad, and they went many years back. The kids are brought up in USA. So there's a lot of cultural differences. And first they are taken to counselors in or rehabs in the USA. And in USA, the counselors are more bothered about protecting themselves legally than to actually do some good work, because anybody can sue them, you know, clients can sue them. They cannot talk to the family and validate. And if you know alcoholics and addicts, they'll cook up a lot of stories. So they need the client's permission to even speak to the parents. And so there are a lot of issues. And the American counselor cannot really understand the family dynamics of an Indian family. So they're going to say, if the client is 19 years old, that why are you staying at home? You know, you leave the house and chill outside. While here we have alcoholics who are 45 years old and still living with parents. So we need to, the counselor needs to understand all these cultural factors. Now, let us address some myths. A lot of people say that, you know, you should have strong willpower and come out of your addiction. Now, yes, the alcoholic and addict already has a lot of willpower. On a dry day at 2 o'clock in the night, he's able to go and get his booze. That is willpower. So you don't get recovery by using willpower. He's already using a lot of willpower. He's drinking despite everybody advising him not to drink. So what is required is the opposite of willpower. He has to now surrender. He has to say, it's not my will. I will now follow direction. So he has to start listening to somebody and following their direction. And we also believe that alcoholics are basically, you know, drunkards on the streets or our maids' husbands or people living in huts. Not true. Some of the alcoholics are very rich. They are highly educated. They are very apparently very successful. And actually, they protect themselves by having a lot of sex and, you know, people around them. So it's got nothing to do with education. It's a disease that can attack anyone, however rich, poor, educated, whoever you may be, whatever religion, it doesn't differentiate. It can attack anyone. Then alcoholics believe that, you know, if I drink, I'll be more popular, I'll be with the cool crowd. But basically, if you keep on drinking or using alcohol, you're going to get very lonely because you're going to be shunned by family, friends. Then alcohol, some people believe that alcohol is good for their health. You keep hearing, reading some article or the other. But I would recommend fruit juice instead of alcohol, because alcohol is dangerous. There's no doubt about it. Some people say, you know, that he himself has done all this to him himself. So let him come out of it. It's very difficult for an alcoholic to come out of it. He will require outside assistance and help. Then they say it's his problem, but actually it's not his problem, because his addiction is impacting his family, his friends, colleagues, and employers, and of course the nation at large. They losing man hours, the medical costs are going up. Then the good capacity myth, you know, this is a very common thing. You know, some people say, oh, I can drink 6 pegs and then drive. The thing is, if you can drink 6 pegs and drive, that means you definitely have a problem, because your body has developed a tolerance. If a guy who's not an alcoholic, you give him 2 pegs, he'll go into a coma. So you definitely are heading for a major problem. Then this is also very common psychological myth, you know, Devdas type of things, because some people say he's drinking because his girlfriend has left him. So he's very sad. So gham ko bulane ke liye wo pira hai, ye wo. But tell me, whose girlfriend has not left him? whose wife has not nag him, whose boss is not strict. Everybody has problems, but alcoholics and addicts are not able to cope with that problem without normally without resorting to some substance. So that's it.
Wow, wonderful, wonderful, sir. I would like the audience to please give a round of applause to Mr. Luther for some time with our own capacity. So I won't have a personal question for you. And I'm trying to know if addiction can also be termed with lust for money and success. Is that an addiction too?
No, I would. You see, this all comes under the eroded value system, which we can't call it an addiction, but if you go back into our old Indian philosophy and or even the Christian philosophy, that lust, greed, kaam, krodh, lobh, moho, ahankar. Yes. So this is all part of our personality, which, if you are an alcoholic or addict, then these aspects of your personality become more grand.
Vulnerable.
Yeah, more vulnerable, but you're not capable of achieving that. Because if you're drinking too much, how can you become successful? How can you earn money? So you get more frustrated. And once you get more frustrated or you keep failing, then you start blaming other people and drinking more, because that's another excuse for you to do that.
So we have this moderation that's going to happen, and to moderate with the presentation that you have led through and the speaking that you have led through, we have Mr. Pratul Chaudhary, a M.Tech and civil engineer and structures from IIT Kanpur. He's been administrative officer and engineer in railways, the Southeastern Railways, and he's also been on the development board for Ahmedabad Metro, and he's also been with the Mumbai, the Delhi Metro. So right now he's officiating a project in Bangladesh, a railway man, as I can call him, a expert on structures. Sir, Pratul Chaudhary ji, you can...
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, yes. Kapil, and thank you, Mr. Luther. First of all, I will thank you for the details you have given, because I was not aware of so many things. But I will give some, my personal experience in this regard. When I was working as the in charge of the workshop of railway engineering workshop at CD, which is near to Jamshedpur. So I had to go to, Valsad in Gujarat for some inspection of some material being supplied. So one gentleman was accompanying me, a class 4 staff. I was not aware, but he was an alcohol addict. So throughout the journey, we were going via Vadodara. So throughout the journey, he could not take alcohol. So in the night, when he was sleeping, at that time I found that he was not able to control his hands. They were
tremors. Shaking.
Shaking and tremors. So I realized that there is some problem with this man. So, and that was really a withdrawal symptom. Yes. Anyway, the next morning I took a train to Valsad, and I was in the chair car, AC chair car, and naturally he was not entitled. I thought I should ask him to sit there itself, but somehow I sent him to the non-AC compartment for which he was entitled. So when I got down at Valsad, I had told him to get down, but he was not there. So I got worried. Probably he was carried away or whatever. So then I went to the station master, gave him the details and told him that if he comes back or somehow he finds out about him, then he should inform me. When I went for the inspection, came back, I did not get any information. I returned back to Sydney. When I went there, then I came to know that near Sydney, very near to Sydney, near Chakrapur, he fell down from the train and died.
Oh.
So that, I was just shocked to know about all this. Then I read about a certain thing. And then in the workshop, the money lenders, they were, giving them a loan, and they were interested in making them drug addict and alcohol addict. So some pouch, they were selling pouches, that Deshi Sharab and all that. So they, many of the workshop staff, they had become addicted. So I talked to the SP and then requested him to get that unauthorized thing stopped, and gave some lectures also to the staff and all that. And I think some improvement was there. But that withdrawal symptom problem, it becomes so serious. It can be.
Yes. As I said, it can be life threatening.
Second thing is, for me, myself, my experience, I have tested different types of drugs. That means I have tested weed also. I have taken a lot of alcohol. And my capacity was quite, tremendous capacity, you can say, which is a wrong thing. But I did not develop, this addiction. Why? I'm just unable to understand.
So you have two questions.
Well, as I said, there are two possibilities. One is that you are not telling us the truth. You're in denial. Second is, as I told you, that 2 out of 10 drinkers develop a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that every person who drinks alcohol is going to develop a problem. So you probably don't have that predisposition, genetic and biochemical predisposition. Mm-hmm. So, you don't have a problem with alcohol.
Yeah, because, whenever I take alcohol, there is a function or something like that, and alcohol is available easily, then I take it. Sometimes I take it too much of it. And I feel also, that I'm overdrunk and all that. But I don't do it in my house. I never take it.
Yeah,
I only take on occasions when there is some gathering.
Yeah, that is good. But sometimes what happens is, we never know when we cross the line.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
No, but what can you say? You are yourself an experienced person. I have consumed 7 bottles of Hever's 10,000 beer.
Yeah. What happened to you then?
No, I'm a drunk, but I was sitting in the inspection carriage and I went to return back from Asansol to Agra.
Well, I don't know. I can't say. We'll have to ask your wife.
No. I have created scenes, no doubt about it. I have done for those things. But then it was not like, I became a regular affair. What I'm saying.
No, as I said,
at that time, a challenge was thrown to me. That's why I did that. But in any case, I am telling you on some, New Year Eve party, in clubs, railway clubs, we used to celebrate.
Yes.
And drinks were available in plenty. So I used to experiment. So put whiskey and then put rum over that, no water, rum and whiskey combination that I used to take, and that too 5-6 pegs or 7 pegs could I tolerate.
Ibiza.
Why I have not got any.
Well, I appreciate the fact that you know, you are so being so candid and honest.
Yeah.
But next time somebody throws a challenge that you should jump out of an aircraft without a parachute, please don't do that.
No, naturally. I can't do that. So any person interested in this? Because it's a very, very important topic.
Yes. I can put it up for the floor and we can have people ask questions. And I can give you 10 minutes for the questions, please.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Yes.
Are you addicted too, Nandita?
No. So I just wanted to ask, I'm hearing a lot about drug addiction, which is rampant in the Bollywood these days.
Oh, yeah.
How this has become... not so deep, not so normal for them. And I've heard some of these Bollywood, on YouTube and other things saying that it's so common that we don't even think there's anything wrong about it, having, these rave parties and things like that. So my question was like, where is the line that you draw and you say, this is normal and then this is not, and then... do you think that, that has really also killed a lot of, what's happening in Bollywood today because of this breakdown, and they're just completely, the NCB is completely taking charge of, catching all of these guys, which, and for them, they feel that it is quite normal and there's nothing abnormal about it. So do you think it's a good thing that's happening? And what do you say is the line where, between a private life and then something which becomes beyond it?
Yeah, first of all, addiction is not just prevalent in Bollywood, it is everywhere. As I said, it doesn't discriminate whether you're a film star or whether you're a techie or you're a doctor. Or in fact, in professions like medical profession and all, many doctors are, especially anesthetists and things like that. Secondly, in India, traditional drugs like weed or marijuana.
Yeah.
Rajiv Gandhi actually made it into an illegal drug. Before that, it was not any illegal because of pressure from World Health Organization. We get it every street corner. So, and as time goes by, different types of drugs enter the market. For example, some years back, cocaine had entered, and then during my time, it was LSD. Cocaine and heroin were not available at that time, but speed was, that is amphetamine. And now more drugs like Yaba and methamphetamine are there. So whatever you do, there will be a certain percentage of people always having it. We cannot sit here in moral judgment that because you're in public life, so you should not be taking drugs. Drug addiction is so powerful that you don't bother about whether you're in public life or whether it's impacting your family or whatever. And I think this NCB going after them is more of a, this is my personal view, more of a kind of a, they have an agenda after this one film star. I don't know what it turned out to be, quite a messy affair. Smoking weed, though I personally feel that it is a dangerous drug, it can lead to psychiatric problems. There's no doubt about it. But then people say that it is being legalized in certain countries or states of the United States. It's not being legalized because it's not a dangerous drug. It's been legalized because it's too much for the prison system and law enforcement agencies to start monitoring and keeping, spending money and keeping people in jails. And legal or illegal doesn't mean that it is dangerous or not dangerous, because alcohol is legal. And alcohol is the most dangerous drug, isn't it? So legalizing it doesn't mean it's not... So it's a very complex this thing, but let us not only think in Bollywood, it is, they're also under a lot of pressure, you know. They have to perform every time, and then they have to look good. They have to, they have only one shot in life. You can probably change your profession and, you know, but they really can't. They're finished if they, their career.
The showbiz.
Yeah.
Punjab is also having a problem of this.
Yes. We'll take one more question. Yeah. Anybody?
True. Punjab is also.
I wanted to ask one question.
Yes, sir.
If possible.
Yes. Go ahead, sir.
It's a little academic question, Mr. Luther. I used to teach safety management also. It's one of the favorite subjects of mine. And one of the fundamental principles in safety management, or rather the surprise in teaching safety, is that everybody knows that something is dangerous and it should not be done, and still people do it.
Yes.
Maybe you call that the denial factor, something like that. Do you find that in treating addictions? And if so, can we develop a sort of common strategy in dealing with this issue?
Yeah, we have programs for dealing with addictions at the workplace. You know, because again, as I said, 10% of any population is likely to have a problem. So when you have a alcoholic or addict, few people in your company, then there a lot of impact is there. Number one, employee morale. Number two, high absenteeism. Number three, possibility of accidents. So many other factors are there which directly impact the productivity of the company. But you'll be surprised to know that even companies go into denial. I'll give you an example. There was one company, a government company, which makes armaments in Hyderabad. And they had their doctor, medical person in charge, had been calling us and saying that, please visit us. We have some alcoholics here and they need, you need to help us. So we couldn't go. So after about 10 days, I said, okay, you know, I'll come now. And then he said, no, I never said we have any problem. Because what had happened was, 2 days before that, the prime minister had visited that place. And by mistake, somebody fired a missile. You know, and so now that probably that guy had a hangover, or he was drunk or whatever. And they didn't want anything, any probe, any kind of person to come and say, you know, you have these kind of people on their roll. They had about 3,000 employees. How is it not possible that somebody has a alcohol problem? So company safety, productivity gets greatly impacted by addictions. That's why we have what is called EAP, Employee Assistance Programs. It is not very popular in India, but we have done it for ITC also. In fact, I was doing a presentation for the general managers and vice president and board members of ITC, Bhadrachalam in Hyderabad, many, many years ago. And after this presentation, they had said, you know, we have 300 employees in Bhadrachalam out of 3,000 who are possibly addicted. So we built up a program. They said, but before that, the managing director turned to one of his vice presidents and he says, but before you do anything, you pick up this man right now and take him. He was a senior guy who had been troubling them for years. And they had given him a position where he had no say or whatever. But, you know, I literally had to carry him in my car and take him to the rehab straight away, you know.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
One more last question.
Rahul.
Yes. I have one question. I'm Mookambika.
All right. She's next in line. Yeah.
So what is it about addiction with people? You know, sometimes we feel that also is an addiction. You know, you keep talking to someone at that particular time for a fortnight, you get addicted to it. And yeah. especially girls and teenage girls, they go through this a lot. And anybody for that matter, like even middle-aged, you get to one activity for continuously for some time, you get addicted to it. And of course, we get to hear that any kind of addiction is a bad habit. But how do we come out of it, or what is that you have to say regarding this?
Well, how to come out of it is you need to seek help. Maybe, you know, now in this COVID times, you need to take a COVID online consultation with the psychotherapist. But yes, this kind of so-called addiction or dependency, we may call it, emotional dependency, is because there is some unfulfilled need in ourselves. Maybe low self-esteem, and that person is fulfilling it. Maybe, you know, it can be traced back to maybe some shortfall in upbringing, maybe our career, maybe our father was very strict and he never encouraged us, and this person is encouraging it. Whatever, there are so many different factors. But yes, that is why in the list of addictions I had mentioned also love as one of the addictions. You know, some people keep on falling in love one after the other.
So, is that an addiction?
Obsessive compulsive behavior.
Yeah, you can say so. Yes, yes.
It tends more towards that, I think. Yeah.
So I think last question, Mr. Atul Sinha had one.
I was suggesting that, you know, your own story, Rahul, is very, very inspiring. From where you were and, you know, where you have landed. And, you know, if you just share bits of it, your presentation might come alive for the audience, if you would like.
Yeah, I have nothing to hide, as I already shared a bit in the beginning that, you know, I got into addiction because I used to believe that, you know, I used to believe, like all alcoholics and addicts do, that I'm smarter than other people. I'm more intelligent. And therefore, I can get away with things which are supposed to be dangerous because I don't need to follow the rules and regulations of society. That was my thinking. So while most of the people in college were studying, you know, I was fooling around, I was going late, I was popping pills, I was smoking charas, whatever, all kinds of things. Yes, initially I was very successful. I had produced a play. I had in theater. I was a big name in Hyderabad, etc. That also got into my head and reinforced the fact that I was more capable than other people. This is a trait which I later on discovered that all alcoholics, addicts have, even before alcohol and drugs come into their lives. And slowly, my addiction progressed. I went through all the things that addicts go through, you know, a lot of job losses. But every time I used to justify it, and I used to think that, you know, this job is not good enough for me. So and so is better. My father was quite influential, so he used to always arrange something or the other. Finally, you know, I fell in love with who's now my wife. Fortunately or unfortunately, I'm still in love with her. At least that's what I tell her. And finally, I met her in a rehab. You know, I was admitted in a rehab in Bangalore, and she'd come for some training. And then I pursued her. And my father went to her parents when I told him I want to marry her. He went to her and her parents and said, "See, don't marry my son because he's an alcoholic." And she, like usually girls do, she believed that with love and care, she will repair me. So she agreed to marry me. And I got married. And the situation kept getting worse because it's a progressive disease. And finally, I shifted to Hyderabad. And I started staying with my parents. And then situation was getting very, very bad. And my father suggested to her to divorce me. And as I said, he threw me out of the house. He really supported her. She was a working woman. My daughter was very small. And then I went to one rehab. I revolted there. I went to second one. Then I went to a third one. Then I came out. I relapsed. Then my wife told me that I will watch you for 3 years. Because I was very keen to get remarried to her. She said, I'll watch you for 3 years. If you are sober for 3 years, only then I can agree to get married to you, but no guarantee. Then finally I got sober and I was sober for 3 years and we had a court marriage again. And then I had a son. So the son is a sober child in the sense, and my daughter was greatly affected. She had to undergo a lot of therapy because she saw me drinking and all that, you know, all the drama. And then I asked myself after I got remarried that what is it that I know best in my life, you know, because the question was now what to do. I was in advertising before that, and I saw that as we grow older, our technology gets, you know, then when I started off in advertising, there was no computers, you know. We used to work with zinc blocks and telex machines and all that. Then these DTPs came, and then fax machines came, and then things were getting. Since I was in the creative field, then even the creative context changes. You know, the younger generation thinks in a different way now, and we are getting older. So I realized that I will not be able to last in this for too long. So I asked myself, what is it that I know best in life? And I realized that I know addiction the best. Why? Because I've spent 25 years as an addict. And now I know recovery also. Now I know treatment also. And I looked around me at that time. This was in 2002. And there were no good rehabs in India. Only very rough and tough places where it was like a prison. So my wife and I, we decided to start a rehab. I had no money. So I asked my dad. So my dad, you know, he had given me so many money for so many projects and he had every time lost. So he said, I don't trust you anymore. You know, why should I give you any money? So then my wife convinced him and he lent us 2 lakhs. We started the company with just 2 lakhs, you know. And within 6 months or 8 months, I paid him back the 2 lakhs. And slowly we grew and then we became, today I think we are one of the best known brands in addiction treatment in India. We have foreign collaborations. I have traveled all over the world, seen other rehabs, Europe, UK, USA, everywhere, Far East, Middle East. Clients have come from all over. Okay. And then
next time I can do it.
Yes, sir. So as we come to the fag end of the story, we have this. Any final points, Luther?
Oh, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Luther. Thank you so much for enlightening, enchanting, inciting, and enthralling perspective. We have this vote of thanks from this wonderful lady down south, Mukambika Ratinam, who hails from a small town in Pollachi near Coimbatore in Tamil Nadu. She's a software engineer and she's also a farmer and she's a motorsports person. And her achievements include driving from Coimbatore to London in car in 70 days. What an achievement. And she now represents a secretary for women and child welfare for this party called Makkal Needi Mariam, which is set up by the great actor Kamal Hassan. And she contested parliamentary elections from the Pollachi constituency in 2019. Wonderful achievements. Can we have Mukambika giving the final vote of thanks?
Hello all. Thank you so much for this opportunity from the Zena. I'm with Rajiv Bhaiya from the beginning of Zena. So it is our great opportunity to host this kind of show, and we've been dreaming about for from the beginning. I thank each one of you, anchor Kapil and Neeraj Pratul Chowdhury, and also our speaker Rahul Luther. So it was fantastic to know and talk about the tea addiction, which especially, sorry, I'm a teetotaler, so it was good to know to help others. I do a kind of lot of social work here, and similarly, even for others, it will be helpful when we are family issues and many other things. We go to the local, in the, you know, rural areas for the police station, to the police station, and help them. The task mark, especially in Tamil Nadu, you know, it's taking a toll. So it will be really helpful in especially me in my day-to-day affair. Thank you so much for touching different areas and various aspects of the addiction. It was wonderful the last 2 hours. Thank you. Thank you all so much.
Nandri Mukambika. With my little Tamil that I know.
That was wonderful.
Nandri. Thank you. Okay. Could we have this final Zina anthem played, please? Nandita, if you could do the honors of playing the final Zina anthem.
I need to be just made the host.
Right. That's Mr. Rajiva. If you could just have Mr. Nandita made the host. We have the final Zina anthem being played and the closure announcement followed by you. Could we have Nandita being made as the host so that she could play the final Zina anthem?
Okay, just a second.
सीना परिवार हमारा चारों ओर खुशी फैलाने का है अपना नारा हम सदस्य सीना के हैं सीना परिवार हमारा चारों ओर खुशी फैलाने का है अपना नारा कष्ट भरी हरने का हम संकल्प उठाए धरती को कुटुंब करने के लिए प्रयास बढ़ाए कष्ट गरीबी दुख हरने का हम संकल्प उठाए धरती को कुटुंब करने के लिए प्रयास बढ़ाए हम सदस्य सेना के हैं सेना परिवार हमारा चारों ओर खुशी फैलाने का है अपना नारा सबको रोजी रोटी हो और सबको हो खुशहाली हो निर्बाध विचार भावना सदा सीखने वाली सबको रोजी रोटी हो और सबको हो खुशहाली ओ निर्बाध विचार भावना सदा सीखने वाली सदस्य सीना के हैं सीना परिवार हमारा चारों ओर खुशी फैलाने का है अपना नारा दया क्षमा नैतिकता हो और हो सम्मान सभी का सबको यूं अपना माने के दिल ना दुखे किसी का दया क्षमा नैतिकता हो और हो सम्मान सभी का सबको यूं अपना माने के दिल ना दुखे किसी का हम सदस्य सीना के हैं सीना परिवार हमारा चारों खुशी फैलाने का अपना नारा सदस्य सीना के है सीना परिवार हमारा चारों ओर खुशी फैलाने का है अपना नारा
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for this wonderful attendance on this Sunday evening. Thank you, Mr. Luther. Thank you, Mr. Patol. Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you, all the 20 other participants who came in for today. Thank you all. And we have this wonderful Sunday evening coming to an end. I look forward to see you all soon. We have this final. Any Rajivaji, you want to say, add something before we call it a day for today?
I think, Kapil, in your special, unique way, okay, we have been blessed by, okay, Rahul Bhaiya's induction in Rana family. So you can welcome him. And I think,
all right,
the best person to welcome, if you allow, Nisha is an excellent shayari bolne wali. So Nisha, agar aap, are yaar, ek welcome kar do. Oh, dekho, bhag gayi. And only you can do, please.
It's me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, put your hands together for the new journey into the Zina world. The man from Hyderabad, my senior from HPS. A wonderful person, human being who fought it all the way, and fortitude with attitude and with solitude and with zest and zenith. He's now with us and conquering all the boundaries, conquering self. And please welcome Mr. Rahul Luther. Welcome, welcome aboard. Welcome all. Welcome, welcome everyone. Welcome. Now you're officially on today. Welcome, everybody. Yes. Rajivaji, any final comments?
No, I think it was very wonderfully done. And I would like that when Pratul Bhaiya was so intently trying to influence Rahul Bhaiya, and Rahul Bhaiya gave him a clue that is it a denial kind of thing? I was only recollecting that Rahul Bhaiya had also said that वो बाजू के सुब्रमण्यम के घर में ऐसा होता है, मेरे साथ ऐसा नहीं होता है.
मैं सिर्फ चार ड्रिंक्स को मिक्स करता हूँ, वो तो पांच ड्रिंक्स को मिक्स करता है.
There's an ad being played called "Men Will Be Men and Men Will Always Be Men." With this final notes, we call it a day. Thank you all for this wonderful evening. Global Reach Foundation, Jenna and Jenna family, to all the wonderful people joining us. It's me, your host, Kapil Dev. Until next time, with another topic, maybe another presenter, with all of you people, we'll be back. Until then, it's me signing off, saying goodbye, adios, amigos. Love you all. Take care and God bless everybody. And we all are survivors and we live this world in a better place. Bye-bye.